second part of the 3478A multimeter series. And this time I want to talk about the battery a bit more in detail and especially how to replace it. Yeah, since there's not much on YouTube yet, I will do this section in English. But there will be a German audio track in the file, or at, if you're at YouTube, I will link it somewhere in the description. So, since my last podcast was in German, a short overview over the 3478A multimeter. So, it's a high position multimeter with 5.5 digits, so you will get a lot of digits. And the series was built around 1982, as far as I know, but they went well after that. I think this unit I've got here is built in 1986, so, well, over 25 years. And yeah, as already mentioned in my previous one, this units rely on a battery. So a lot of multimeters you will find on the market do have hardware calibration. So if you open up the unit, you will find a lot of trim ports or trim caps, which are used to adjust your accuracy of the device. This device does not have this sort of calibration. It uses a software-based calibration. So it measures the difference between a reference and whatever it reads. And this difference is stored and used for calculating the proper result. To store the, this calibration, this unit does not use an EEPROM like most newer devices do, but an RAM. So to prevent losing your calibration if you turn off the unit, this one does use a battery to store the contents. So if we open up the unit, you will find the battery on the left side near the transformer. In this case, it's a black lithium battery rated at 3 volts. Depending on the age of your module, you may find other batteries at, I think these are at 3.7 volts or 4 volts. But anyhow, your RAM does need about 2 or above 2 volts to maintain its content, so you should be fine with a 3 volt battery nevertheless. So while these batteries can last an insane amount of time, I mean, this unit is now over 25 years and was turned off for years and still is completely functional, you may not want to rely on this old battery for your device. Because as said, if this battery dies, your content in the RAM will be lost, you do not have calibration and your device is somewhat useless. Also, you cannot entirely be sure about the remaining capacity because these batteries have a very steep discharge curve at the end. So even if you measure the full voltage, you may be near the end of the lifespan of this battery and would be bad. So to prevent losing my content, I bought a new battery. This is also a lithium battery produced by Panasonic. The form factor is called 2/3A or whatever it's pronounced. And well, these go for around 5 euros. I think this is $7 or something like this. And yeah, I hope this works exactly as promised. And so I will try to replace this battery in this video, but there are some problems you might encounter. So I will note them before I start. So, okay, if I would remove the battery, I would lose power and this would void my memory content. So I have to supply any voltage while I solder out the battery. The first thing that I could do would just be to solder in another battery in parallel. I guess I will go with this 3220 or the 2032. Whatever, you can get this very cheap from old PCs. And this is the first way. I'm going to solder it in and not just use clips because, well, clips may come loose and this would be a bad thing. And the second idea would be to just turn on the unit, because if the unit is turned on and connected to mains, the transformer will supply the needed voltage. Well, the latter idea with connected mains still has a big trap that will ruin your day if you don't think about it. Because the digital section of this multimeter is connected to chassis common, so that's mains earth. And let's just take this soldering iron and, hey, guess what? If you measure mains earth and the tip, you've got a connection. So if you would touch the positive battery pole with this soldering iron, you would essentially short the battery and, hey, there it's gone. Fortunately, the tip of my soldering station seems to be isolated, at least I couldn't measure anything, but I will still take the safe way and will not connect this to my mains earth, but use this inverter with a battery to power the, this device, so I will not have mains earth and I will definitely not short anything. And if you do not have an isolated soldering iron or an inverter, just let your soldering iron heat up as usual and then unplug it before you start to solder. The remaining heat should be enough to remove the solder and, well, if not, plug it in, let it heat up and plug it, unplug it again. Okay, since I will try to modify my unit a bit, I will talk about the inner workings a bit more, at least regarding the power routing for the RAM. If you just want to replace the battery, you may skip ahead. I will try to give an annotation or something in the description. So first about the memory itself. The memory is located near the front above the label U512. This is this chip here. In my case, it's a NAC. Right next to it, on the left side, is capacitor number 510. You may have other descriptions or other components. There are several revisions of this board and this may differ. And to look at the power distribution or the diodes that I am looking for itself, these are near the transformer and these are these two on the top of the camera. These are filtering the incoming waveform of the transformer. And the one at the mid, about here, is a diode that will inject the battery power to the unregulated rail. So the idea I've got for the final unit, I will try to tap off these two diodes before they come in, so on the positive side. These are the two transformer taps providing about 5 volts. Then I will feed this to an ultracapacitor, and this ultracapacitor will also be connected to the unregulated 5-volt line. So if I turn off the unit, the ultracapacitor will provide the power needed to maintain the RAM for some time. So if I turn off, I won't instantly need to discharge the battery. This is mainly interesting to replace the battery again, because, well, I can take off the battery and the capacitor will still maintain the voltage. And to protect my cap, which is only rated for 5.5 volts, I will use one of these crappy old 78LO5 power regulators. This is a linear regulator and, well, according to the data sheet, it should have internal current limiting, so it won't just blow up if I, well, essentially short it, because an empty cap is like a short. And, well, hope this is correct. So, as said, I won't take any risks, so I soldered the battery directly to the leads that I want to connect to the multimeter. And just to be sure, well, a bit of tape has never done anything wrong. So let's add it. Okay, good. Our battery is now ready, our emergency battery. This will only be used if the power fails while I am soldering, so okay. Next step, we will hook it up to the multimeter, to the multimeter itself. So okay, I will connect the negative lead of the battery to the chassis itself and the positive lead to that cap. As already mentioned, this cap is your only reserve, so you want to make sure that you don't fuck up at this point. I will use this diode, so if something is wrong with the battery, I still have at least AC power. And my soldering iron is now connected to the battery, so to my inverter.
And my cable is not long enough. Bad.
Okay, soldering iron in place. I also attached the wire to the battery. I know it's a bit out of focus, but well, just soldered on and a little bit of tape so the lead doesn't touch the case. And as such, shot my whole battery again. And let's put this diode in. Okay, looks pretty good. Guess we can keep that. And turn off my soldering station because my battery won't last very long on heating, with turned on heating. So, okay, we should now be able to detach the battery without losing the contents, even if the mains fail. And yes, of course, I do have attached a negative lead, so no worries. So the next problem on my side is the battery itself, because, well, it's soldered in and I won't damage the pads. So I guess I just snip the contacts and hopefully I will be left with some posts which I can solder to again. But the negative side is a bit... Negative side is a bit on the close side because there are many components near. But, well, they are all connected at the board level, so I guess this should be fine. Just going in there and off it goes, hopefully. Do I have it? Yeah, I do. Okay, this was number one. And let's start with number two, but for this I better turn on the soldering iron again and let it heat up. And well, for heaven's sake, let's check if we can do something with our soldering iron. Ah, yeah. Okay. This came off very nicely. There is the battery, and off it goes. Main's still on. I haven't shorted anything. Yoo-hoo. That's a good idea. Negative and positive. Try to remember, because you should really solder in your new battery this way. And I guess I have to hack it a bit because these are very, very large soldering pads, and the old one had just some kind of wire sticking out. Okay, now I have soldered on some leads to the side of the battery, and well, just have to take out this last bit of wire. Damn. Bit of windy here. Get the window open because it's somewhat hot in here. Oh, come on. So, okay, here we go. You can really hear the transformer of my soldering iron. Guess it's not really happy about this modified sine wave. My inverter does put out. So, check the polarity again. Looks right to me. Minus on minus, plus on plus. And let's see if we can get it in. So, okay, I'll try to start with the negative side. Whoa. And there goes my battery. Damn. I guess I will have to improvise a bit. Okay, switch to the heat up solder and let cool down mode. Hopefully with some result. Okay, negative lead is in. Oops, sorry for the camera.
I guess I will let the soldering iron heat again.
Yeah. Dropped around 40 degrees. Let's go a bit higher. Guess the board is somewhat high quality, so higher temperatures should work. At least somehow. And next round, plugged off. And positive lead. Okay, guess that should count as soldered. Heating up, not heating up, what? Okay, still hot. Then I will add some more solder. And the negative pole. Yeah, adding solder really drops the temperature. Ah, come on. Thanks God, this soldering iron got a reasonable heat here. So it's back on operation temperature fairly quick. This really helps in this situation. Whoa, oopala. Just got a lead a bit and burned away the isolation, but well, okay. Guess that's just ground, so just some electrical tape and it will be fine. Battery is in, looks good to me. And there's the lead I accidentally touched. Well, as you see, not really a big deal because the isolation is not completely burned away. So yeah, this should do the trick. Okay, new battery in. And I think the device should be good to go. Let's test it. So, okay, moment of truth. I checked with the multimeter. Battery is at 3.3 volt. I disconnected my current cell and, well, let's turn off. Crossing my fingers. Yay! Self-test okay, so the memory is still okay. Battery seems to work. And, well, okay. This would be the end of the story, but I said I do want to modify my unit. If you want to follow, well, keep on watching. If you just wanted to replace the battery, you can stop here, I guess. The rest of the video won't be for you. Okay, I a bit of changed my mind because I think I can drop the 78LO5 because this thing at the side here looks to me like an 7805 linear regulator, and its output is 5 volt, which is perfect for me. So I already started capping this, cutting this wire, so well, I guess I'll continue at this point. I will take the 5 volts output and supply this to my cap and backfeed it to the unregulated voltage. Or at least I hope I can do this with some diodes. And well, hopefully this whole concept works, so the cap charges if the power is on, and when the power is turned off, it will discharge to the unregulated output, which in this case should supply the RAM. And finally, a little look on my hack, or let's say my tape maze. I tapped off the 5 volt output of this linear regulator. This is fed through a resistor to limit the current and a diode into the cap itself, so it will charge from this 5 volt rail. Additionally, there is an output diode
that is attached to the unregulated 5 volt line via the cap near U550. This goes directly to the RAM. So if the unit is turned on, the cap will charge up through the resistor and the diode at the linear regulator. And if it's turned off, it will discharge through the output diode into the voltage for the RAM. I sadly still cannot measure how long this cap will last because, well, first my only logging multimeter is a Unity UT60E and this has 10 megohm input resistance. So I bet the multimeter will discharge the cap faster than the RAM would. And additionally, the battery is still in parallel. And this means at least if we go down with the voltage, the battery will slowly take over and the cap will stop discharging at full rate. So, well, now we have, 14 hours since I started my test. And the voltage of the cap is still at 4.2 volts. It started off at 4.8. So I guess we should still run on cap and I guess 13 hours is a good figure to reduce the load on the battery. Most likely I will turn this unit on nearly every day so the cap will charge up and the battery won't be touched. And while I have this thing already open, I also changed the transformer tab from 220 to 240 volts. We currently use 230 here in Germany, and I think, if I recall the spec correctly, the allowed voltage to the below the set voltage is a higher range than above, so 240 should be fine. Okay, I guess I will come to an end. I hope you find this video useful. If you do so, please vote it up on YouTube. And if you do change your battery, I cross my fingers for you that you will retain your memory.